Yeah, Michael's studio is in Providence. What I remember really clearly is the view beyond his window, which overlook the car park of a school bus depot. But there was just this sea of yellow, all parked, uniform, totally silent, totally static. Like his work, they capture the spirit or the memories of all the lives that interact with them. His work is minimal. It's familiar. There's something about a state of disrepair or dilapidation. They're not necessarily broken things, but there are things that have reached the end of their useful lives. They can be really funny, but they can be quite violent as well. There can be something jarring about them. He doesn't ever use titles for work, or very, very rarely, but actually all the action happens in the list of materials. So instead of looking at the titles, look at the list of materials. So when he's in his studio, he'll select an array of materials that are, I guess, the ingredients for an exhibition. But then in this very limited period of time, he'll bring together the objects that he's worked on in his studio with the architecture, the lighting. I mean, there's a long history of artists in art history making interventions to a building to show you what an institution does, that these aren't neutral spaces, these are really highly calculated spaces that make you behave in a certain way or think in a certain way or move in a certain way. Through the changes that he makes to a building, they become a kind of platform for the sculpture or become part of the sculpture in its own right. In terms of materials, he uses basketballs a lot. You know, it's the perfect form, it's the perfect sphere, it looks like the world, it looks like eyes, it looks like a head, so it has this kind of bodily thing. There's a lot in his work to do with looking and making you look and making you look a bit harder, but also about being looked at. And these are, you know, in a pretty cartoon way. The work bugs on the wall, one of them's a VHS tape player and the other one's a DVD player. These are devices that were meant for playing videos that you look at. You can't look at them anymore because they're defunct, but instead they've kind of become these two eyes that are looking back at you. You know, these are modes of communication that have been cut. The TV that's flat on the screen has no power lead and it's facing down. You couldn't look at it even if you wanted to. It's just sort of given up and gone flat on the floor. There's a lot in his work that deals with the fundamentals of life. Milk, liquid, this fundamental fuel, the body, but also that cycle of consumption and waste. I think this milk jug becomes like a fountain as well, fountain of life. It's pouring, it's giving its abundance, and then that drains away. And like fountains do, they often recirculate and come round again. We say that the galleries are empty, and maybe they are when you first walk in, but they're not empty, they're full. They're screamingly full. They're full of, you know, traces of the last exhibition, the last person who painted it, the cleaners. There are marks, traces, noise. Emptiness also means lots of different things to different people. On the one hand, it's about luxury and cleanliness and order. But the other extreme is also, you know, absolute removal. It's lobotomy, it's theft, it's being robbed, it's eviction. And those polar opposites, ends of human experience, are all things that he's talking about and wanting to bring into the frame. I think it's quite nostalgic. It makes you think about what is no longer there. What's remembered, what's left behind is only a trace or a feeling or a mark or a gesture. He's dealing with ghosts.